Welcome to the Estancia Alegre's production of The Complete Horse, The Complete Peruvian Horse. We're going to try and take you viewers on a path, a step-by-step process of how we evaluate a horse since he's born, what we think is good, what we think is not desirable, and the purpose of illustrating clearly what you should look for in the end in a horse. The first thing that you have to keep in mind though is that the origin of this horse was basically what the Spaniards brought. They brought a horse that had Berber blood, product of the Moorish invasion of Spain in the year 700. And that horse itself had mixed with the local Jacas and the Celdon horse of the Celtics. That's a horse that comes originally to all of America and then slowly becomes a specialized horse. And that is basically fixed by the environment and the participation of men. In the case of Peru and the case of Central America, where cattle operations were not important, we look to perfect the ambling gait, whereas, for example, in Argentina or the United States, the ambling gait was put aside to favor the trot, which will produce a much faster horse and more apt to run after cattle. In the case of the Peruvians, after the invasion and conquest of Peru by the Spaniards, the horse was primarily used as a traveling animal to cross the valleys, 50 something odd valleys that are present in the Peruvian coast. The deserts are really very dry deserts, they're drier than the Sahara. So what people wanted was a horse that was efficient, i.e. with the least amount of beats to cover the greatest amount of ground. They wanted a naturally gaited horse that had also a great deal of brio. What is brio? Brio is that hidden virtue whereby you just get on your horse and he will take you as long as you want without having to be asked for it. He'll just give his all to you when you ride him. First thing that you have to take note of is that this is a naturally gated breed. That is why we use a colt in this case. He's a March-born colt, i.e. he's 2.5 months, pretty big. He's good full-bodied colt. And what you have to notice here is that without any aids of any kind, this little horse will gait already. He's a natural horse. The gait, which is the essence of this breed, is what the Peruvians search for consistently over a period of about 400 years since the horse first came with Spaniards, is a four-beat lateral gait. You will see the colt and you'll see the dam, and they have a sequential beat. There's a rear left followed by the front left, followed by the rear right, followed by the front right, in a 4-beat sequence that you will notice later is also has to be harmonious and even musical, so that in the end it is reflected in the rider. If you see the rider is like he was in a rocking chair this time. It does not move, it does not bounce, because that's what the 4-beat lateral gate permits is. Now, as I was saying before, what the Peruvian breeders looked for was a naturally gated horse. And over the years, they have successfully attained this, as can be clearly seen with a little colt. Here we have another example of what I was saying before. What the Peruvians looked for predominantly was a gate. Again, you see a very young filly, this one is younger than the colt before, that gates all the time. Left, rear, followed by front, left, followed by right, rear, followed by front, right. You see the tail set, it hardly moves. This reflects the sequential harmonious beat, or the 4 beats, which reflects again in the rider. You can see the knees of the rider. He's comfortable. We're going to talk about conformation now. And I was saying before, we'll use very desirable examples and very undesirable examples, so that you can get a clear idea of what you should look for. This is an example of a very desirable phenotype of a female. She's a chestnut mare, a very deep body. That's something we want. A very prominent chest and very sound, good legs. I'm going to try to point the things to you so you can follow me through. We'll start with if you don't have legs, you do not have a horse. So first thing you have to look at is the hoof. In the case of her, she has a nice big hoof, which is very, very desirable. The bigger the hoof, the bigger the distribution of the weight on the impact of when contacting the ground is. That's good. You want a short pastern. You want a very well-defined fetlock. Fetlock has to be like your knuckles, dry. Okay, this one is a very nice fetlock. You want short cannon bones, both in the rear and in the front. Then we go up. She has a beautiful muscle here. She has a very good angle here. This is a scapula humeral angle, very pronounced. The more pronounced, ideally, the looser the horse will be to be able to move his arms. I will talk about later. Her neck is perhaps a trifle short, but it's a very well-defined neck. It's curved here, straight here. The head is your typical Peruvian head, subconvex, i.e. sort of Roman nose instead of the Arab, which is a convex, concave. The ears are long. The eye is very expressive and a little bit slanted. Now the back, she has a very straight back and a very good coupling with the loin. Here, this is where the weight of the saddle goes. So this part of the horse has to be compact and very strong, very, very strong. We go to the rear. She has very nice rear. Overall, her hindquarters are nice. Her tail set could be ideally perhaps a little bit lower, but it's very nice still. She has a good, very good hindquarters. This muscle here is very well pronounced. She has a good gaskin, and she has, Roberto, you can turn her around. There, just there. She has very good thigh. Going further down, we want to, this is something that is terribly important, this breed, and this is what one of these things that makes this breed special. This is a breed where we want a lot of angle in the hock. The more you want an angle here, at least 140, 142 maximum, and ideally 138 and closer. Why is that? Because we want the whole action of this part of the horse to drive under in an action that is completely towards the ground. So, and you want the least amount of beats. So the more angle you have here, the more ground the horse will be able to cover. So she has a good hock, good angle at the hock, very good angle at the hock. The hair has to be abundant, and that's something we like, a lot of hair in the front and the rear. Now, look at the chest. She has a deep, very deep rib cage. Rib cage is pronounced because you wanted a horse that could have a large lung capacity to be able to breathe efficiently. And that would be accompanied by a big, or reflected in, better still, in a big chest, which she has. Very nice dam. One thing more that we have to point to, and this is very desirable, she has very good knees. Her knees are straight, which is something that is very important. They are not forward or back. They're straight, solidly coupled knees. Very nice. Here we have a very good example of a male Peruvian stallion. So one thing that is very obvious and very important, a male has to look like a male and a female has to look like a female. No question about the masculinity in this individual. Head, as I was pointing before, subconvex, eye a little bit slanted, ear long, expressive, alert, neck well arched in the higher part, straight in the lower. And if you take this part of the horse and you put it on to a Lusitano or an Andalusian, you will come to realize why they're relatives, because they really look alike. Shoulder is a long shoulder, it's a pretty good shoulder. Could be longer. The scapula and the humerus are okay. Good muscle here, good muscle there. The back is excellent. Very straight, short, very well coupled to a very good loin. Excellent loin, actually. Good muscle here, the thigh. Good muscle here. Good tail set. Pasterns are good, the cannon bones are good. He could have a little bit more angle at the hock, but the tissue of the hock is good. The testicles are there, big and well pronounced. Roberto, can we see him from the rear? Hindquarters are all pretty good. Substantial horse. in general terms, the knees are straight. It's a good, solid sort of horse. And on top of that, he's big. He's probably about 15 hands, no? 15 hands, which is a little bit over the average, but I think we would agree that it's about a perfect size. Yeah, Morot. Okay, we have brought here a gelding for comparison purposes only, of what is desirable and what is not desirable. If you remember, I was pointing out that in the area of the hindquarters group, we want a tail set that is as low as possible, and I did say that this mare could have a little bit lower tail set, and we want a lot of angle at the hock. If you go, you'll go to the, straight to this horse, this small gelding. His tail set is not what it should be. It's a high tail set, very high tail set. And more pointedly, he has very little angle in the hock. So this horse, when he moves, will always have a great difficulty in getting to amble and getting to push. We pointed out a serious structural defect on a Palomino gelding, and here we're going to point out another serious structural defect in the case of this young chestnut mare. Basically, the issue with her is the support quality of the articulation here. The fetlock could be much better defined. It's sort of a meaty fetlock. It's like this, this part of the hand, not like this. It's a little bit perhaps exaggerating, but the idea, you have to get the idea. It's not very well defined. And secondly, even though the pastern is relatively short, it will cede a lot. It's too elastic. So that is very undesirable. Same thing in the rear. You see, without any weight, those pasterns go way down, way, way down. In the end, what you will have is a horse that lives a shorter, useful lifespan, and the other thing that will reflect negatively is in the quality of her movement, which we will be able to point out later on. We have brought this mare along because she is an example of an undesirable trait within a very desirable horse. It's typical Peruvian circumstance. It's things that we wish were better and cannot really be. It's a very fine mare, very pretty mare, very well, very, very, if you look at her skin, the quality of her head, the expression, her bones, she's a little bit light, but the issue with her resides here. Even though she has a wonderful, wonderful, truly wonderful back, very good loin, very good tail set, excellent tail set, she has absolutely no angle at the hock. She's, you can see her, is straight, practically like this. This is what we in Peru would call a pata de gallo. It's a posty-legged. It's a very valid case of a posty-leg. Posty-legs, as I was mentioning before, are not desirable because they're going to make really make very difficult for the horse to drive under themselves with their rear legs. Keeping on with this mare, if you see the rear leg pasterns, they're practically one at basically the right is already horizontal to the ground, and the left is about to do the same thing, and that is because she does not have any angle at the hock, i.e. no distribution of the weight. So all the weight of the whole hindquarter goes and concentrates in the ligament of the fetlock, and that's what really compromises the long time health and soundness. Okay, this mare pointing out other defects. This is a very good, nice mare. I really like her, the her pasterns. They're short. I really like her fetlocks. They're big and wide. But she has two defects, structural defects. First of all, she's pigeon-toed, i.e. both her hooves are pointing inwards slightly. And the other thing, if you see, is that she's open in the front, i.e. she's her build here ends up being a trapezoid. So she's like this. Problem with that is that the weight concentrates here and there. And that also will compromise the horse's long-time health. This is another example of a Peruvian. In this case, this is a 19-year-old mare, which is good. And we're happy to note that she's perfectly sound for her age. She's continuously ridden. It's a very nice mare, long, very expressive head, beautiful eye. There it goes again, a little slanted, a little Chinese. Long ear, long neck, good shoulder angle, very good here in the back. Don't forget she's 19, so she's going to not be as straight as she would have been. The coupling of the back with the loin is excellent. She has a very large croup, very large, and all the muscles are there. Interesting enough, there's an issue with her. If you think about it, you notice this. She does not have that much angle at the hock. She has some. However, what helps her out is that the tail set is so low that the whole position of the bones in the pelvis are rotated down. That means that she's like this, and by being like that, that helps her out distributing her weight better, more evenly. You go and look at her from the front. She has a big chest, big chest. Very good flat knees, excellent fetlocks, excellent pastern, and very well-defined cannon, ligament, and tendon. Very nice mare. Okay, here we're going to specifically pay attention to the rear ends, okay? A rear end in any type of horse has to be muscular and with big bones so that you can, as I mentioned before, pack a lot of muscle in there. Very good, very wide, very good muscle, impressive actually. And with a very nice tail set. The second case, we have a very fine mare, very light, lighter bones, small, short, with a very good tail set. The third case, we have a tail set that, a croup that is wide. But the tail set is too high. And the fourth case, we have again a very large mare, big bones, and a big rear end. We have to look for the size and the position to have a better rear end. Okay, the tail set has to be as low as possible, as I've mentioned before. So, if we had to grade the quality of these horses, that would be the order. We have two big tail sets, rear ends, big bones, big muscles. That one has a lower berth to the tail than this one, slightly lower. This one has a very nice berth to her tail. But she's very light, and that one has a very high tail set. Very high tail set. And so his group is like that, so something that is not very desirable. Okay. This is an interesting situation because it's, for illustration purposes, we have here four basically very pretty well-built mares. And the idea is for you to get a clear idea which one would be the closest to the ideal horse. First we have here, the four of them are chestnut, by the way. We first have, don't do that. First have a mare with a very deep body, very big bones. Her head could be more feminine. She has a little bit, she's a little bit coarse in the head. She could be more feminine. Her neck could be a little bit longer and more arched. Her body is, again, very wide, which is very desirable. Here she's a little bit higher on the croup than she is at the withers. And that is something that is not desirable, because that will make the ability to move under to more difficult. What is very good with her is that she has a very big set of bones here, very, very large bones. So how much power can she pack? It's right there. The bones will determine how much muscle can she has. And that reflects this very large thigh and very large all over croup. Tail set. Her tail set is okay. It's okay. That's number one. Now we look at her from the front. She's pretty massive again. Okay. Now, number two. Here we have a much smaller mare. Again, she has her face is okay. Nothing special, but she's a nice face. Long ears. Her neck could be a little bit thinner. She's a little bit light on bone, in my opinion. Would like more bone, more fetlock. Her loin coupling with the back is pretty good. She's a little bit, again, higher here than she is here. But very, very, by very little. She has a very nice tail set, very, very nice tail set. She's very well, nice rounded here. She's very good in the lower part. Ahí nomás. Póngase usted al lado. You see her from the front. She looks fine. She's okay. A ver, póngala de nuevo al costado. One thing with her is that she could have a little bit better angle here at the hock. She is okay, but she could have a little bit better angle. Number three, she has a nice subconvex head. Very typical. The ears are nice. The neck is a very well-placed neck. Very arched neck, it's all right. Vertical here, curved here. She has a very pronounced angle, again, of the scapula and the humerus. You want those two to go out like that. Good muscling here. Her fetlocks could be a little bit drier, more better defined, but she's okay. And her pasterns are fine. The back is very good, coupled with a perfect loin. It's very nice here, really very nice. Very strong here, very, very strong. She's very deep, good rib cage. Tail set is good. The croup is very big. The bones here again are very big, as practically as big as the first mare. Good muscle, good angle of the hock, and good cannonballs. You look at her from the front. She has a deep, wide chest, which is something we want. Okay. Then we have the last one, which is the one we used to as an example to begin with. So what is better this one than the other one is that she, her cupping here, the withers are perfect to fit the saddle in. I mean, they're hidden, but there is enough wither there. The saddle will fit. And she's a little bit taller here than she's here. So she's very, very nice. Now we're going to place these. This mare has a prettier neck, a prettier head than her sister. However, the tail set on the sister is a little bit better, and the proportion between the tibia bone and the cannon bone is better in this case. This one has a much larger tibia than cannon bone, practically a 2-to-1. Whereas in this case, it's a 1.5-to-1. So theory will tell us that this mare will move better. And since what we're looking for is a phenotype consistent with the tool that will help the horse move better with a greater ease, this one will be a better mover. Okay, thank you. We're going to talk now about brio, temperamento, temperament and genio. You have to bear with a narrator this time around, because these are things that you're going to have to watch for and look for before you understand them. It takes a lot of horse knowledge, a lot of patience to really get into these things. These three terms are they are all different. They have a different purpose and describing attitudes of a horse, while they're also very closely related. And it's difficult, therefore, to make a differentiation between them. The combination of these three characteristics end up being a description of each horse's individuality. No single one of these attributes can be present by itself. Genio, in the dictionary, it is the nature of an individual. Here we have two mares. If you see, they will react differently. Will you get on the other one, please? Hold the other one. They will react differently to the halter. It is basically the nature of a horse to respond adequately to the rider's commands in an orderly manner. It is very, very important then, because a poorly trained horse can become difficult to handle. In the case of La Estancia Alegre, that would be very difficult to happen. Temperament. Temperament is a physiological condition characteristic of an individual who will modify its reactions in accordance with different situations that may be encountered. In the case of horses, temperament is a natural attitude. It can be desirable. A horse can be noble, calm, stable, or undesirable. A horse can be nervous, excitable, or even violent. Even though temperament cannot be changed, with adequate handling, it can be handled, applying patience, knowledge, and tact. Brio, according to the dictionary, is a thrusting force, its determination, its style, elegance. The synonym of brio is courage. I have selected this mare because, to my understanding, and having had the pleasure of riding her, she has what I understand to be brio. Brio is an innate quality. Nothing can be expected of a horse that does not have brio. For example, a horse without any brio will not have any impulsion. That's one thing you cannot perceive in this mare. This mare you see, she's always expressive. Look at the, follow the ear. The ear is going back and forth, i.e. she's talking to her rider. When the ears are back, it's because she's very, very, she has a presence, she has the rider's presence on her. When the ears are forward, it's because she's looking forward, saying, okay, which is my element? What am I doing here? What am I supposed to do? When a horse, after responding with brio to its rider's command, is stopped, and the reins are released, and the animal remains standing, allowing the rider to mount and dismount, we can regard this horse as one that has given in without initiative and at the rider's orders, free of bad habits. Roberto, please stop your horse. Lose those reins completely. Dismount. Mount again. Loosen those reins. Do it again. Brio, as I mentioned before, is a concealed attribute, but it is always there permanently ready to manifest itself on being required by the rider through body language, and that's basically rein and leg use. Roberto, will you please pressure her with your legitimate brio is not conditioned by pain or by fear. There are no spurs here, and this is not a scared horse. Okay, we're going to show you a sequence of three young horses being trained the bozal. Bozal, which is a part of the integral part of the training of the Peruvian horse, it's very important. It's a stage where its work is well done. It's the horse will muscle and gain suppleness. Here we have a young gelding, which is extremely well gaited. He has what I would understand to be a sobre andando gait, where the rear covers with great ease, without horse hurrying up, the print of the front, cover it by two or three hooves easily. So that's a sobre andando gait. Easy horse, nice pastures, easy mover. Where do you see this, that the horse is an easy mover? You can hear it, you'll see the harmonious sequential movement, and that will be reflected in the rider's knees. You can see the knees are very easy, they're not moving practically. And you can also see that in the tailpiece. It covers the tail. The tailpiece is very quiet, that reflects good movement on the part of that horse. Okay, this is the second halter, bozal horse we're going to show. This is a young filly. She's really big. She's a huge animal. So, a lot of terminal in the front. She could have a prettier head. And her gait is not as harmonious or as synchronic as the first horse we saw, the gelding. You can make a comparison by the sound, basically. No? Now, one thing that this one has is very, very nice, we look for, and it's very desirable, is the termino. Termino, T-E-R-M-I-N-O, is how much they can move, rotate the front hooves out, sort of an outward crawl type of moving action. In this case, she's a filly, sealed bay, I guess you could call it. We really think that she could have a prettier head. Her head is not very feminine, rather coarse to have on a female. But on the other hand, beautiful is that which functions well. And in that sense, her motion is very, very good, especially her rear legs. They have a very, very nice skimming action towards, and they really go push decisively forward, whereas the front have enough elevation. This is a good Paso Llano Natural in this mare. This translates again into a very smooth riding horse with a very quiet tailpiece.
In this section, we are going to introduce you to the different types of gaits based on Don Luis Ascasubi's ambling theory and Dromoplan. It is important to keep in mind that the description of the different gaits is based on how much the hoof print of the rear foot passes that of the front. It is not based on speed, as is widely misconceived. The examples we will show are limited by the horses that are available. In the following section, we are going to have an analysis of the various types of gait. The list you are seeing now contains a detail of both desirable and undesirable gaits, to which I will refer as we look at the different horses in the upcoming section.
This horse is very deficient in his movement. He's what we call a passitrot, i.e. the predominant beat in this horse is not lateral but diagonal. However, and it's a mingle between the lateral gait and the diagonal gait, it's a smooth trot. See, the knees of the rider do not particularly move. However, if you see him and you listen to him especially, you're not going to see any paca-paca. You're going to listen to a different type of movement altogether. As a consequence of the horse having little angle at the hock, he has no extension.
This is a good example of a Paso Llano Golpeado. As you can see, the horse has a lot of front arm movement, especially terminal. However, because he's structurally deficient in the rear, he has a high tail set and a lack of an adequate angle at the hock, he cannot drive his rear legs under the body, making him quite an uncomfortable ride. Please watch the rider, please watch the tail set. Note that even as he is ridden at an accelerated speed, he cannot cap.
He's a very good example of what could be known as Paso Llano Picado. Paso Llano Picado is a natural Paso Llano, but that short step. So in effect, what happens is that the print of the rear hardly, it just gets in contact with the print of the front. So you're going to be able to see it right now. Almost half of his feet are, he does not stretch, he's not elastic enough. So therefore he cannot have the enough suspension as to keep his legs under him, himself in sufficient time so as to permit the front to extend. So in end you have in general terms, a very short stepping horse. This is a very good example of a Paso Llano Natural, natural Paso Llano. It's really a four-beat gait. The rear legs skim the ground, decisively push forward to drive under the belly of the horse, and the front have a sufficient extension and elevation as to accompany the rear legs in the free-flowing forward movement action. This ride, the Paso Llano Natural, is a very smooth ride. There are predominantly, practically three hooves that come in the ground at the same time. of rider is very comfortable, as you can see, and the tail piece, which covers the tail, is without any movement. It has harmony and synchronicity. This is another very good example of a well-gaited horse. In this case, we have a large gray gelding, pretty horse. The virtue that this horse, again, this is a Paso Llano Natural. He has very good drive from the rear legs. He has good proportions too. He has good angulation. What is shorter cannon bones and the tibia. That combination of factors permits him to extend himself well forward. He is a very nice horse, very smooth gait. You can watch the tail piece, even though the horse has his tail is not as snugly fit into his buttocks as it should be. He's still, that the tail piece is dead again, very quiet, which is something we desire and we want. Have a very nice four-beat gait. This is a gray mare, about 6 or 7 years old, very well built, perhaps excessively compact, but by the same token, very sound. You see her pasterns are very short, perfect, they're thick. She has really good hocks, very round croup, very powerful. Her gait is an interesting gait. This is what we would call a sobreandando. What's a sobreandando? It's a gait where, as I mentioned before, the hoof print of the rear will cover easily two hooves after hoof print of the front. It's one of the most desirable gaits. If you follow her hoof beats, it's not a distinct paca-paca like it is in the natural Paso Llano, but it's more of a slack, 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 which is what tells you that the beats are closer together. This is a gait that is where the beats are very close together. You get a horse that practically goes in the huachano. That means that instead of a four beat, it's a two beat gait, practically. And you see, this most likely it's the movement that the horses that originally came from Spain had, which was known as the Paso Castellano. It's a relatively smooth ride, but it is not as smooth as any of the four beat gaits. You are going to see that in the rider. So she has she's in a rolling type of movement all the time. Now you hear the horse, the contact of the horse's hooves on the ground. It's practically a two-beat gait, right side and the left side, and they go together. Even the huachano is, as I'm saying, it's the mother gate. It's the gate that came from Spain. But it has become, with selection, an undesirable gate, because we understand that it is not an efficient gate. We want, as mentioned before, a horse that drives with his rear leg decisively under himself, and with the least amount of gait can cover the greatest amount of ground. And with this gait, they cannot. Single file, please. Give yourself a distance, about a two horse distance, there. one change only. No, two changes actually. A ver. Roberto, salga usted por delante. Ginger, you follow Roberto, please. Barbara, follow Ginger. Victor, will you get... you follow younger Victor? Yeah. Okay. Victor. This is a horse that specialized in the desert. Carried its rider comfortably for very many hours with brio, with soundness. And the comfort, in essence, comes from what we call the piso, which is the gate. The gate, as I was also mentioning, the main element is that you have to, with the least amount of beats, i.e. with keeping the greater, reserving the greatest amount possible of energy, cover the greatest amount of ground. Here we have a class. We have six horses, and I have placed them in what I understand they have the best gait, piso. This is the winner of the class. She is a mare with Paso Llano Natural, natural Paso Llano. And she's a very finely, she's smooth, she has impulsion, she has overreach, she has elasticity. You can see that when the rider asks her to stretch out. And she does not have much front leg action, i.e. termino extension. Extension she does have. Termino and elevation, she does have extension. She's the winner of a class because she has, of the four important attributes, she has three and an important part of the fourth. This is the second, I've placed this gelding. Second in the class. He's very smooth, again. He has a lot of impulsion. He has overreach. He has elasticity. And he also has less termino and less lift. However, he moves very nicely. There is also a natural Paso Llano. I played this small gray mare in the third place. She is what we call a Sole Andando gait. She's very smooth. She has, as the name of the gait, what it explains it, she has more than good overreach, a little bit less impulsion. In the front, because of that, she's very plain. She has not much extension, or none at all. And she has also she does not have much terminal or lift. I've placed the bay gelding in fourth place. First of all, he's very smooth. Again, he has enough impulsion, just enough. His overreach is more a product of him balancing himself a little bit. But what I like a lot about him is that the action of his rear is very close to the ground. he's a Paso Llano, natural Paso Llano. One coming here, I placed in fifth place, because he's smooth enough. He has impulsion, but he has very little extension and overreach. He has difficulty there. That is reflected in the seat of the rider. This ride is a bumpier ride than the other rides. You see the rider itself, the action of the rider with the saddle. It's not as smooth as the others, not as easy going. In the front he has some nice action. He has some terminal, there you go. Tail set is relatively quiet, but he makes a Paso Llano, but just barely. He's nearly more a Paso Llano picado than a Paso Llano. That's why he comes in fifth. Sixth place, I have placed this gray mare, aging gray mare. I like her a lot. However, probably because of her age, she's not as trained as she should be, and she does not let herself be looked at. However, the action in the rear, as you can see, the action of the hocks is not a quiet action. There's a sort of a bicycle action there in those hocks, which reflects immediately in the rider. So even though she has a natural Paso Llano, fair one of that, if not a sobreandando, normal regular action, she does not quite skim the ground as most of the others do with the rear action, with the rear legs. That's why she comes in last. Summarizing then. It is a gait class. There are four main elements that we look for in a gait class. First of all, please remember this is a traveling horse. You want a horse that goes at the speed that the chestnut mare is in, or at the speed the two first horses. You see they're long, easy strides. They're very efficient. So if you go in a long distance, these horses will have no problem in keeping energy to keep on going. Don't forget they were selected to be ridden 8 or 10 hours a day. Those two of the first are very efficient horses. The four elements that are important in the gait. First, smoothness. Look at the knee of the rider, look at how the rider falls into the saddle, how that saddle moves, or how little the horse moves in the saddle. Second element is impulsion and overreach. Impulsion is how much the horse drives his rear. The mare in front has impulsion, you can see it, and overreach, i.e. the print of the rear leg passes easily the print of the front leg. Same case with the gelding in the second place, same case with the two other horses that are placed up front. The third mare, the gray mare, is in a sobreandando, and the seal bay gelding. However, you see the bay gelding that is in the fifth position. He does not have enough the overreach, nor does the mare behind. One, because of lack of correct angulation, which is my understanding what happens in case of the bay gelding. He sort of does not have enough angulation at the hock, and his pasterns in the rear legs are a little bit too elastic, so they get too close to the ground, too horizontal with the ground. He loses the impulsion there. In the case of the mare, because she does not have that skimming action that she should have, she has a bicycling action. And then you have the element of elasticity, which is like the elasticity, we could define elasticity basically as the gear shift of an automatic car. You see the two first horses, clearly are the ones that can stretch out. The others have great difficulty in doing so. Two first can do it with great ease. The third mare lacks the elasticity to stretch out. So the fourth, the bay gelding, or seal bay gelding, lacks the strength in the rear legs, and so do the other two. And finally, last but not least, it's the front leg action. None of these horses is characterized itself by great leg action. However, the mare that wins the class, again, the chestnut mare at the beginning, has, because she has enough impulsion and overreach, she also has a great deal of extension. You see those four arms extending easily forward and projecting the angle of her scapular humeral joint, which is very, very desirable. Thank you.